Tobela, San Bonani, Abusheni, Nda, Molweni, Kwimore, and good morning. Thank you very much. My name is Teboho Maponya. I'm the program director of today's occasion. And without any waste of time, we are going to start with our program, and I would request that each one of us can get settled so that we can be able to proceed. Thank you very much. On that note, allow me, ladies and gentlemen, it is that time of the year where grade 9 learners have to start considering possible career choices, since this would influence their choices of subjects for grade 10. The aim of this information session is to assist learners in making informed choices about their intended careers, career paths, and give guidance or guidelines to learners and parents in making safe and responsible choices of subjects for grade 10. Learners will also be informed about the University of Pretoria submission requirements and what the Junior Tech program entails. With your visit to the different faculties, I believe there seems to be light at the end of the tunnel as what subject choices you would definitely make. Allow me at that point to welcome all the grade 9 top 10 academic achievers of selected Gauteng schools as well as schools in other provinces. Grade 9 junior techie members, parents of the above learners, life orientation teachers of the selected schools, UP staff, Prof. Goren Hoff in particular, Mr. Wallace Isaacs, Dr. Peter Klasse in absentia, Mr. Pietras Lombard, senior student advisor present here today, the JT admin staff, and Junior Techie Student Ambassador Society members. You are all welcome to this function. On that note, ladies and gentlemen, Dames en Heren, I declare this function officially opened, and please help me to welcome on stage our very own Prof. Carolina Gurenhoff on stage to give an address to us. As she ascends the podium, may we request Jan to play us what he has to play. Can we put our hands together as Prof. Gurenhoff comes to the podium? Thank you.
Thank you, Teboho. Good morning, ladies and gentlemen, and especially our grade 9 learners, our parents, our teachers. A very warm welcome to the University of Pretoria on this marvelous, well, I would say no longer autumn, winter's morning. It's beautiful outside there. We are literally a week from the exams starting, so if you don't see many students around, it's hopefully because they are studying for the examinations. They're probably sitting in the library. It's an important time for the University of Pretoria. As Teboho said to you this morning, we are concerned about the choices that our grade 9 learners make, because those choices has a direct effect on their future careers. Now, in grade 9, you need to choose your grade 10 subjects, and many of our learners sitting here this morning know what they would like to do. I was looking downstairs at the Rotenbach Hall and I saw them all clustering around the areas that they're interested in studying. But there are many grade 9 learners which at this point in time are not sure what they would like to study. And therefore, it is so important that we advise you as to the right choice of subjects for your grade 10 and onwards. Because if you have the wrong subject choice, you may not be able to enter some professions which you may decide later, grade 9, in grade 10, 11, and 12, should be your career choice. So it is also important when you choose your subjects to build some flexibility into your choices. Because even those of you, the grade 9 sitting here that's going to say, I'm going to be a lawyer, you might come to grade 11 and say, no, you know, law's no longer what I'm looking at. I actually want to become an actuary. And so therefore, it's really a very important time in your life when you choose your subjects. It is also important not to make the mistake which many, many learners make, and that is to choose your subject choices on, oh, these are easy subjects and I can get distinctions, and if I do this, I'll get 6 or 7 distinctions. I do want to warn you against that, to just pursue distinctions and not look at what is the right career choice subjects for you. So we also this morning going to talk to you about the admission requirements, and I would urge you to not just look at one, look at a second choice and a third choice, because this will then help you, if you know what the different admission requirements are, to make sure that you are choosing the right subjects. We also this morning going to explain to our young people here our Junior Tikki program. Now, if you look around, you will see our young people standing there in red T-shirts, and they've got JT here. They are our Junior Tikki ambassadors. They are assisting us here this morning, and thank you so much for that. This is really a wonderful program because we start working with learners and prepare them to coming to the University of Pretoria, and that's why it's called the Junior Tikki. So now to parents, I just want to say to parents, do not underestimate the jump between completing your high school, your matric, your national senior certificate, to coming to university. It is a major gap, a major jump. It is in the school, it's highly structured. Teachers make sure they do their homework. Then they come to university and suddenly they're one of a huge groups, large classes, nobody particularly looking after them. Many parents also stand back because they think these are now adults, they must look after themselves. And our biggest risk of losing academically one of our learners is in the first year. So we've designed the Junior Tikki to support our young people, that the adjustment in their first years is much easier, and they also start making friends, that they don't arrive here and they know no one. So I really, if you're not already a member of the Junior Tikki, I really urge you to join us. We have some wonderful value-adding opportunities and projects that will assist you with your school career as well. Many of you know the University of Pretoria already, but there's some of our parents and learners here that might not have been to the University of Pretoria as yet. And so I do want to share a little bit of information about the University of Pretoria this morning. The University of Pretoria is recognized both nationally and internationally as one of our leading research intensive universities in Africa. Some of you might not know, but the University of Pretoria is also one of the oldest higher education institutions in South Africa. We were founded in 1908 in a small house that is called Kayaruasa, and that house was standing in Skinner Street. What our alumni of a few years ago then did is they moved the house brick by brick. They gave us a large donation, and we moved that house brick by brick from Skinner Street, and it is now standing on the property of the University of Pretoria at the gate, the main gate, Roper Street, which unfortunately is closed this morning. But for those parents who's going to, with their learners, who's going to take the campus tours, they will probably show you Kayarusa. And so there's where it started with four professors, and I believe it was just over 20 students, and I'm told that the professors thought that they were overworked, and so did the students. During 2017, the university produced the highest number of research unit outputs in South Africa. So we had more research units than any other university in South Africa. We're very proud of that. We had 2,040 units. We also in 2017 produced the highest number of doctoral students in South Africa, 355. And by the way, that is the highest output ever in the history of the university. The University of Pretoria has 9 faculties, and we have 1 business school, and we are spread across 7 campuses, of which the Hatfield campus is one of them. If you've already visited downstairs in the Rotenbach Hall, you would have come across our faculties. But let me just list them for you. It's the Faculty of Engineering, Built Environment, and IT Technology, the Faculty of Education, the Faculty of Economic and Management Sciences, the Faculty of Health, the Faculty of Humanities, Faculty of Law, Faculty of Natural and Agricultural Sciences, Faculty of Theology, the Faculty of Veterinary Sciences, and then we also have our Mamelodi campus where we do our bridging programs, and then finally we have our business school, which is situated in Illovo in Johannesburg, the Gordon Institute of Business Science, which is also known as GIBS. If I look at the number of students, currently the university has just over 53,000 students spread across all of these campuses. And we offer 1,357 programs. So this is a very wide choice of programs, and some of them obviously postgraduate ones. But because of the wide choice, it is so important that you do your homework, that you know what it is that you would like to study. The University of Pretoria is particularly strong in professional programs, and we are accredited by a whole host of both national and international professional bodies. And here I'm thinking about medicine, veterinary, actuarial sciences, accounting, engineering, architecture, industrial psychology, a whole host of them. Recently, the ranking, there's a whole host of ranking agencies which ranks universities internationally. And in one of the ranking agencies, I think it is the World Ranking, the university had 6 of our disciplines which came in the top 1% internationally. And these were agricultural sciences, clinical medicine, engineering, environmental sciences, ecology, plant and animal sciences, as well as the social sciences. If I look at another ranking, international ranking, and this one is called Quaccarelli-Simmons, and there we had 5 of our disciplines ranking in the top 200 in the world. These are theology, agriculture and forestry, law, architecture, and then built environment. Our law school has recently been listed in the top 100 in the world, and is the leading law faculty in Africa. We're also very proud about our graduates, and an independent study recently indicated that at the University of Pretoria, 91% of our graduates who've just graduated will within 6 months find a job. And I think that is a very important statistic for parents to consider. We, if you look at some of the other rankings, you will also see that the University of Pretoria is one of the top universities in South Africa, which is preferred by employers when they are looking for graduates, not just in South Africa, internationally. During April, it's a very, very busy time at the University of Pretoria. Then we do our graduation ceremonies. And this is always a very joyous occasion when our students get their degrees. During our April graduation ceremonies, and we refer to that as the autumn ceremonies, we had 32 graduation ceremonies, and we awarded over 11,300 degrees, certificates, and diplomas. If you consider that of all of the graduates in South Africa, 10% of them comes from the University of Pretoria, and if you consider that there are 26 universities, you can see proportionately the importance of our contribution to the skills in South Africa. In actual fact, I looked at a recent report of the Department of Higher Education and Training, and that report says one in every 10 degrees awarded in South Africa comes from the University of Pretoria. 17% of all master's degrees come from the University of Pretoria, and 15% of all doctorate degrees awarded in South Africa comes from the University of Pretoria. We also are responsible for producing 27% of all engineers every year in this country. And of course, as you will all know, 100% of the veterinarians. I'm very proud because in my own training, I'm a chartered accountant, and I was very pleased earlier this year when I saw that our BCom accounting sciences students who are training to become chartered accountants in the first examination, the qualifying examination of the South African Institute of Chartered Accountants, we had a 94% pass rate. And of the top 10 in the country, two of them was from the University of Pretoria. So we're very proud of our students. We do a lot of research at the University of Pretoria regarding the success of our students. The success of our students is extremely important to us. So in 2017, we launched a very specific project that is unique to the University of Pretoria. That project is called The Finish Line Is Yours, and it's directed at our students. Now, they've shortened it with an acronym, Fly at UP. So if you see Fly at UP, it's not literal, it means the finish line is yours. And what is the purpose of this initiative? The University of Pretoria has invested quite a lot of resources to support our students to complete their degrees in the minimum time. Now, what does this mean? For a BCom degree, it means that you will finish your BCom degree in 3 years. For an engineering degree, it means you will finish your degree in minimum period of 4 years. In other words, you will be finishing with your incoming cohort. You will all be finishing in the minimum period of time. And what we've done is we have created a whole array, almost a whole infrastructure, a wraparound infrastructure to ensure the success of our students. So for example, we have a learning management system, an electronic platform where there is a host of information for our students called Blackboard. We've appointed mentors for our first years. We have a whole host of tutors, so there's tutor classes to assist our students. We have faculty advisors who assist students who have problems learning, managing their time, prioritizing, struggling with certain subjects. We've created student learning communities because we find that often peer learning is a very effective way of assisting students. We offer summer and winter schools. So why is it so important for us to have our students completing in the minimum period of time? Well, I think it's expensive to students and parents. If you send your child here for a BCom and they should finish in 3 years and they end up spending 4 years and 5 years, you as a parent will end up paying for the same module that needs to be repeated two or three times. Also, what will happen is that we will delay our students from entering the job market and earning their salaries. There's another reason. We've done extensive research at the University of Pretoria as to why students are successful and why are they passing in their subjects. And one of the things that is very is a red flag for us is if we find first-year students starting to fail certain subjects. So we try and pick them up as soon as possible to give them this wraparound support. But we really also urge our parents to not have a totally hands-off approach with your first years. Perhaps in their third or postgraduate you can do that. But really our parents should be supporting and monitoring results in the first year. You should be helping us because the adjustment in the first year is huge. I trust that you will enjoy the morning with us and that you will be able to collect all of the valuable information on your future career choices. I hope that you will all consider the University of Pretoria as your institution of support to partner with as we prepare you for your future career. I can assure the parents that we strive continuously to attain excellence at this institution, to continuously improve, to continuously raise the bar at the University of Pretoria. But on the other side, we also recognize and celebrate excellence in our learners and in our students. So I and the University of Pretoria, we are looking forward to welcoming our learners here, first by joining our junior Taki, a little bit later on becoming a Taki student, and then within the minimum period of time becoming a Taki graduate and alumnus of the University of Pretoria. Thank you very much for coming this morning, and I hope you have a fruitful morning. Thank you. Thank you, Tebogo.
Thank you so much, Prof. And University of Pretoria, I think, as he has indicated, is one of the best universities worldwide. And the caliber of students that we produce are the ones that are not like these ones that I just want to tell you about before I call somebody else to come and appreciate what the Prof has indicated. You know, there's this thing that I read about, that once there was all these engineering professors who were sitting in a plane, and before the plane could take off, there was an announcement which was made. And the announcement was that this plane is made by your students. And then all the professors stood up, ran, and went outside. But, you know, the principal was sitting, and one guy came and asked, "Are you not afraid?" The principal replied, "I trust my students very well, and I am sure the plane won't even start." So this is not what University of Pretoria is all about. Thanks so much, Prof. Gorenhoff, for such an inspirational and informative talk. While you still remain on the podium, may I call to the stage one of the junior Teki representatives to hand over a token of appreciation to you, Prof, for your continued support to junior Teki and its division. Thank you very much. Over to you. You're most welcome, Prof. And I hope, you know, Prof stood here when I said somebody's going to appreciate, because she trusted that the kind of students that are going to give her a token are one of the best. Thank you very much. Ladies and gentlemen, dames en heren, at this juncture, I would like to request the members of the audience to please complete the evaluation form which you've been handed with, and then you'll be expected to hand them at the doors during your departure. It is very essential for the learners to write down their cell phone numbers at the back of the evaluation forms, because three of you will receive the VUCA loyalty program voucher by completing the form. More details will be given at a later stage at the function as the function progresses. At this point in time, allow me, ladies and gentlemen, as you're going to be doing that, I'm going to request Jan to be playing the two videos that we are supposed to see, and please let us not be disturbed by anything. Let us watch what Jan has to show to us. Over to you, Sir.
Flash mob tiks kamerate, challenge accepted. Ons gaan nou vir Potch. Ons weet hulle doen nie was die sing nie, maar ons weet hulle wil volgende jaar. Maties, flash mob tiks kamerate, challenge accepted. Ons gaan nou vir Potch. Ons weet hulle doen nie was die sing nie, maar ons weet hulle wil volgende jaar doen. So ons challenge jou som om van saam met ons hê. Flashmob tiks kamerate, challenge accepted. Ons gaan nou vir Potch. Ons weet hulle doen nie was die sing nie, maar ons weet hulle wil volgende jaar doen. So ons challenge jou som om van saam met ons hê. Doen 'n flashmob by julle universiteit. En onthou om môre aand, die 18de Augustus, om 8:30 kyk net te kyk, kanaal 144, waar tiks kamerate ons kampanje begin vir was die sing, Back Up Boys. Cheers. Hey.
Thank you very much. Are we still frozen? Can we put our hands together? Thank you very much. Maybe the suspense was so huge that you still expected more, but unfortunately the program has to go on. And please don't worry. When I said we are supposed to check the evaluation forms, I wanted to be sure whether these learners that we've invited here are really able to read and write. Because, you know, sometimes we've got a problem with learners who cannot. Now that I know you can be able to read and write, don't worry about that one. You'll only do it online because now we have went digital. Thank you very much. Thank you very much. At this point in time, I'm going to request, on the stage, I'm going to request Stephen Ball to come to the podium to speak to us about whatever that he has to speak to us about. And I believe when he comes, he'll be able to expatiate what he's going to talk to us about today. Thank you very much. Let's welcome him.
It's more than just a dream. It's about believing that greatness is attainable. All you need to do is believe, and we will make it a reality. Doesn't matter who you are or where you're from. You are never too young, you are never too old to become great. All you need is someone who believes that you are capable. Someone who will elevate you to greater heights. Determination, sacrifice, and expertise prepared to unleash your true potential. And when it gets harder, you'll remember to run faster, kick harder, leap further, and honor the stripe as if your life depended on it. Tuxport will elevate you to greatness. Question is, do you have what it takes to be great?
Ladies and gentlemen, and firstly, thank you very much for this opportunity just to share a little bit about sport here at the University of Pretoria. As mentioned, my name's Stephen. I'm one of the deputy directors here at Tuck Sport, and the Stripe and the Stripe generation is very important to me and to this university. And over the next few minutes, I'm just going to take a bit of your time on a Saturday morning just to share a little bit about who is Tuck Sport and also how sport plays an integral role in the University of Pretoria. And as you start formulating what you want to do one day as scholars and where you want to study, hopefully sport will be perhaps part of that on your radar as well. So over the next few minutes, I'm just going to share a little bit about sport. So we talk about the Stripe generation, we talk about Ticks of Nicks, we talk about wearing our stripe with pride, and you'll see in all our teams that participate for the university, you'll always see the stripe of the university very prominent in all our team gear. We believe that's our armor, that's our battle dress, it's our battle rings like the Olympic rings are to the Olympic Games. A lot of people have written over the years a lot of things about sport at the university. And they, often people want to know, you know, why is there success? And I really do believe that it's part of the winning culture of the university. And sport, like you saw earlier with the Camarata group, you know, sport plays an integral part in creating this winning culture here at the university. People want to know what makes us tick. They want to know how come do our student athletes perform not only academically but also on the sporting field. But at the end of the day, this is what it's about for us at sport. And there you'll see there's four pictures of some of our student athletes that have graduated. If you have a look at the top left-hand corner, there you'll see our Vice Chancellor and Principal, Professor De La Rey, handing over the Honours Degree in Economics to Matthew Britton. And that was the year after Matthew won Olympic gold medal in the London Olympics in rowing. So he was able to keep the balance between sport and academics whilst at the university. On the right-hand side, you'll see some of our Matux footballers who graduated with their LLB law degrees whilst playing professional football. On the bottom right-hand side, Mrs. Emily Gray. She was a three-time Paralympian. At the last Paralympics in Rio, she finished fifth in one of the events, and she also graduated with a B-Sport Science degree. And then another athlete of ours that's very special to us and a lot more relevant in terms of the last couple of months, the gentleman on the bottom left, Akani Simbine, and I can't see all the hands, but maybe just those of you who watched the Commonwealth Games and followed Team South Africa's successes, you'll recall that we had an athlete winning the 100 meter at the Commonwealth Games, and that was Akani Simbine. And last year in September, AK got his degree in BIS from the University of Pretoria as well. So this is what it's about, is finding balance between both your academics and your sport. And some of our athletes, it's about competing at sport at this level. For others, it's about doing recreational sport, and we've got a variety of opportunities there. So maybe just, stats and information is always good, and as we move into this digital era, we want to know more, right? So let me just give you a little bit of snapshots about Tuck Sport. So you'll see on any given year, we have more than 30 different sporting codes at the university. That's quite a few sports. Yes, they've got various priority rankings. Some are more priority clubs, other more recreational clubs. You'll also see on any given year, we have more than 3,000 club members. When I say club members, I'm talking about athletes that compete for the university, for club teams, for junior teams, at a variety of local competitions, international competitions, national competitions. And then we have a group of students that may not be wanting to compete professionally, but they want to do recreational activities. And they compete in what we call our internal leagues. And on any given year, we have 3,000-4,000 students as well doing those type of activities. To give an idea, at the moment, the netball internal league started a couple of weeks back, and there was 52 teams that are competing, all student teams, playing, having fun, doing a sport that they may enjoy, to take their mind also off their studies as they lead up into the exam time as well. And that's not to totally take your mind off your studies, all right? So that's not the intention. Just some of our performances. I've just listed a few over the last couple of years. 2012 was a special year for us. It was a golden year. I mentioned Matthew, but if you think back to that boat that he was part of, all four of those athletes were part of Tuck's at that stage. And all four of them graduated with a qualification from the university. 2013 was a different year because we had, in the past, we had the Varsity Cup Rugby, and now we had these new competitions coming to the fore called Varsity Sport Competitions. And we had the introduction of athletics and football, and there we had a few wins as well. 2014, you will see that our cricket team, for example, won the National Cricket Club Championships for the third year in a row. And a couple of weeks back, they repeated that here on our grounds as we were hosting the tournament as well. We also had the Commonwealth Games, and the same Akani Simbine, and I put it in purposely because I just mentioned he won the gold in the Gold Coast now a couple of weeks back, but 4 years before that, he finished fifth in that event at the Commonwealth Games. It was his first big major international meet. And it, just to show you the progress that our athletes can also make. 2015, for example, 85% of our teams finish in the top three position. So 85% of the times that our teams participate, they finish in the top three. At World Student Games, again showing progression, we had more than 20% of Team South Africa coming from Tuck Sport. So if you take all the 26 institutions across the country, 20% of the team came from this university. And AK won the gold there as well. And there you can see the progression that he was making over time. 2016 was the Rio Olympic Games. We had a boat crew that finished silver medal. It was the year of the silver for us, for example. It seemed like everything we did, we got a silver medal. Silver's not bad, I promise, but it's not as nice as gold, right? But at that Rio Games, for example, Lawrence Britton and Sean Keeling, two students. Sean, for example, has already got two postgraduate qualifications from the university. They finished in silver position. You'll also see, for example, the I mentioned there at the bottom, our varsity cricket team qualified to compete at the Red Bull Championships. And they, over the three-year period, had two wins as well as a bronze medal in the tournament. And that's an international tournament where you represent as a university the country and you represent against other institutions from different countries. And there's eight of the test-playing nations that compete in it. And a couple of months back, we actually qualified to compete again this year in September in Sri Lanka. 2017, in terms of our varsity sport competitions, out of the nine competitions that were on show last year, We were able to bring back 7 gold medals. In our USA, which is our National Student Championships, which is across all the sporting codes, we were able to bring back 9 titles there as well. What does 2018 look like so far? Out of the 3, we're not talking too much about rugby, but it's okay. Out of the 3 varsity sport competitions, so far we've managed to claim the 3 titles. And last week, Monday, our hockey side was the 3rd team, and they beat Marty's down in Stellenbosch, which is always a nice thing to do. Commonwealth Games this year, to give you an idea, we had more than 30 team members of Team South Africa. When you consider that's out of a team of 180 in total, when you look at coaches, team managers, and athletes. The picture on the bottom right-hand side, Tatiana Schoenmaker, for those who followed the Commonwealth Games, will recall that this was the first time a female swimmer won a gold medal since 1954 at the Commonwealth Games for South Africa. And Tatiana won gold in the 100 and 200 meter breaststroke events. What's special about Tatiana is that she's currently a 3rd-year BCom Financial Sciences student at the University of Pretoria. And there you'll see AK and Clarence Munyai, who also brought home a relay medal. So where do we fit into the bigger picture? We are a support service department of the university. Our athletes compete in student competitions, and then they also compete, like I mentioned previously, in local leagues, national competitions, as part of the national structures in sport. Our club programs have a variety of different areas. Everything from our internal leagues that we do in conjunction with our student sports committee and the Department of Student Affairs. The recreational drop-in times, if you go into our sport campus, which is about 2 kilometers from here, the Hillcrest campus, you'll see numerous students going for jogs around the facility and just trying to keep healthy as well. Our junior programs, we've got academies as part of our high school, and then we've also got, as I mentioned, our elite and our amateur teams that compete. Opportunities for involvement. So maybe one day you come to the when you come to the University of Pretoria, let me rather say that, you say, but you know what, performance sport is not for me. I want to keep healthy, but I would like to be involved in sport in some way. And so there's various opportunities, and I see it time and time again, students who come and volunteer in our programs and get involved in the other side of sport, the management, the club governance, the just being exposed to a completely different side of sport. And that's often the side of sport that makes the tick. It's the part that you pick up huge experience. So I think there's opportunities for you as well as a student to do it. If you go into some of the more formalized training programs, for example, in sports science, physiotherapy, maybe sports medicine long term, those students also get involved into our club programs on a practical aspect as well, and get a lot of their practical hours through these type of opportunities. In terms of our facilities, I believe that we are very fortunate at the University of Pretoria to have some of the best facilities on this continent in one place. We may not always have the newest, but that's okay. We have the opportunity for our athletes and our student athletes to train and to do what they do well. So that ranges everything from our tartan athletics track to our hockey astro to our 12-lane 50-meter swimming pool, which is heated throughout the year. And there you can see a variety of different facilities. And I want to just show you a picture that is always special for me to think about, because it makes me realize how the university is always progressing. If you have a look at this picture on the far left-hand side, this black and white picture, where you are seated right now, if you see the athletics track, the grass athletics track in that picture, that's where we are seated right now, where the first athletics track was of the University of Pretoria. And then they decided to build the ALA on top of it, right? But we got another piece of ground. And now you can see, for example, on the next 2 pictures, there you can see the first time we got a tartan track, and subsequently the bottom one, the blue track, was upgraded leading up to the Rio Olympic Games. And that track is the same make of track that was used at the Olympic Games. So the university does spend a lot of focus on our facilities, and that makes, I believe, our sport environment healthy. I often get asked questions around bursaries. And, you know, if I'm a good athlete, potentially a good athlete, are there sports bursaries available? And yes, there are. There are certain criteria that we look at. And if people are interested, you can contact directly into our sports programs, to the various club managers. They talk you through what is the typical things that they look at. And we look at a variety of different aspects, whether it be national rankings, whether it be positional needs, for example, in certain teams. We look at a variety of those components when we do allocate. So finally, just to finish off, I trust that over the next couple of years, as you start deciding what is your path academically, that University of Pretoria is definitely on the radar. And if you have an interest in sport, whether it be more full-time or recreational, that you seriously consider the University of Pretoria. And our hashtag, and if you go onto our social media, you'll see it gets used quite a bit, is Elevate to Greatness. Because we believe that every single one of our students have got some form of greatness inside of them. Thank you very much.
Thank you. That was Steve Ball, the Deputy Director, TAX Sport. And I'm going to request the Junior Techie to come to the podium to present a token of appreciation to him. Can we put our hands together? Thank you. That is very kind of you, even if the token is not given to you, but you're still able to put hands together. Thank you very much. Next on our program, it will be the performance by Aster Hoff. Step It Up. Can we put our hands together as we welcome this rendition on the podium? Thank you very much.
by the astronaut to sleep. How? You rocket! Why do people lock the restaurant on the moon?
Wow.
Because there's no atmosphere.
Tell me how.
I think we can really do better than that. Can we give them a round of applause? Thank you very much. And all I can say is, wow, that is the University of Pretoria for you. And on that note, allow me to indicate to you to say, as the University of Pretoria, we are not only concerned about creating academic giants who are going to become social dwarfs. That is why you can see, with all these people, the beautiful performances that they've made. This was, after all, the overall winners of the step-up competition of all the 28 residences at UP that we have. Can we just give them a round of applause? Thank you very much. And then I want to say to you as parents and learners, to say University of Pretoria is also concerned about, because we are not just interested in making sure that we look at your intellect. We are also having 30 sporting codes that your children can be able to play for. But besides that, we've got the cultural and heritage activities in the form of choirs, symphonic orchestras, your museums, your dramas, and everything, the visual arts at the University of Pretoria, to lighten up and to liven up the life of your kids at the University of Pretoria. And then we also have got the dynamic student structure in the form of the SRCs, the Tax Society, and also our very own Tax FM. And then now, thank you very much. I thought you don't have jealous down and you'd put your hands together for that. Thank you very much. And then now, on that note, ladies and gentlemen, your hand cloppers, many of these young minds here today are still looming in the dark as to what subjects they have to choose while in grade 10 next year. May you kindly take to the stage and help me remove this veil of confusion by addressing subject choices. And then immediately after your hand cloppers, I'm going to request Pietras Lombard to come and speak to you about the junior techie and what it entails. Thank you very much. Johan Kloppers, after him, Pietras Lombard will be ascending the podium. Eight, thank you very much.
7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
Ladies and gentlemen, thank you so much for the opportunity, and now hopefully what I'm going to do now is I'm going to give you information to help you to make informed decisions, but also wise decisions regarding subject choices. So we're going to go a bit into the more nitty-gritty aspects regarding choosing subjects. It will open up more opportunities for you later on, going into career fair or careers that you have got interest in. Now, as you can see on the slide there, the slogan they have there, beg your pardon, I'm going to go back to this one, you become what you study. And that is reality, the reason why we are having a university is because you would like to go and study something to become something at the end of the day as well. And that is what we also would like to encourage to do as well, to start thinking what you like to become, and then focus your attention to go and study those type of things. But let's have a look at the next video quickly first. Indeed, isn't that true? Obviously, that's what we're aiming for, eh? To study without failing. If it comes to making admissions and applying to courses and so on, what you find is, as you can see on the screen there, they look at your final grade 11 results in order for you to submit an application to be considered for selection, or at least to give you conditional admittance and reserving a space for you going into the open programs we offer. Now, in order to get to that point, obviously, it's all going to start by making subject choices this year. So we're going to grade 10 that you already have the right subjects to do. So when you get to grade 11, that you already have a good solid foundation that you can build on, making sure you get the right marks to submit as application then. The reality is we do receive quite a lot of applications. More than 43,000 applications we receive on an annual basis, but we only have space for 10,500 first-year students. So therefore, obviously, it's important that you get your marks as high as possible, especially in grade 11. But for doing that, you need to make the right decisions already in grade 9, going into grade 10 then. They've handed out some booklets there to entrance. It's a small booklet I'm going to refer to now. It indicates the Make Smart grade 10 subject choices. All right. So the information I'm going to talk about now will also be in this booklet. Now, in the booklet, they already start with some steps that you follow, right, in order to make some informed and wise decisions regarding subject choices. The very first one there is gather information regarding possible career opportunities. All right, so that's where you actually start, looking at opportunities and getting information on that and so on. As you can see, there's about six steps you follow, and they actually take you through the whole process of making decisions as you go along on those steps. Now, I know a lot of you sitting here today perhaps doesn't have a real strong indication what you would like to become one day in terms of a career that you would like to follow. I also didn't know exactly what I'd become when I was at your age in grade 9. But what we do have here is some 5 to 6 pointers that we would like to just highlight to help you, to guide you, and to make sure that you make the right decisions at the end of the day in regards to career choices. The very first one at the bottom, I beg your pardon, on the top, it says interest. But I'm first going to go back to the one on the bottom that says the personal vision. It all actually starts there. Where do you see yourself going into the world? What you like to offer in terms of what you have to leave as a legacy one day? What is your purpose? What is your what is your goal in terms of what you want to have an impact on what you're going to do one day? And that starts down with your personal vision. Now, what happens now further on is, if you look at work ethics is something you have to learn already at school. That is the thing that you do when you have to decide to do the right thing at the right time. If I've got an assignment that's due maybe next week Thursday, but I know I've got sports and other culture activities maybe on the Wednesday and then on Tuesday, I'm not maybe have enough times to actually do the assignment and make sure it's on the best level as possible on that Thursday, then obviously you already start this afternoon with that assignment. And that's what I'm talking about. You have apply work ethics and doing the right thing at the right time. And the sooner you learn that, the easier it actually becomes, especially when you get to the university where nobody's going to tell you what to do. You have to decide for yourself. And if you already have developed that work ethics, it makes it much easier going into the university to perform well in the university level as well. But the thing is, it starts at school level already. So if you're already going to develop in grade 9, it's going to make it much easier when you get to grade 10, 11, and especially grade 12 then. Personality. We all differ in terms of our personality. The way we deal with stress, the way we deal with, if it comes to working in teams together, the way we deal with conflict, we all differ in terms of our personality. But the idea then is to choose a career field that aligns with your personality, that you can actually enjoy what you're doing in terms of just being who you are. All right, so you don't have to worry about not being who you are if you actually do the work that you need to do. Aptitude is that skills and abilities you have, that things that comes naturally to navigate through life. That is what we're talking about, aptitude. And you might realize that you've got something that makes it easier for you to do a task that someone else actually struggle with. And that's mainly because you've got a certain certain aptitude that you can do it much easier. Now, sometimes we also do underestimate ourselves. We try to do the easy things. But in order to reach our full potential, we sometimes need to choose the hard stuff as well. And by choosing the hard roads, we also discover that we have got more talents and we can and able to develop that talents more effectively as well. Then interest. The thing about interest is you need to be having an interest in what you're going to study one day, because you are the one that's going to sit in front of the textbooks and have to do the assignments and learn for the exams. You're the one that's going to have to get out of bed one day to go to work one day. And you need to have an interest in what you do. You need to be excited to actually go and do what you want that you have to do as a job one day as well. Whether it's your own company or actually going to work for a firm doing a specific job at the firm itself, you need to have an interest in what you do. And by developing an interest, you actually also are developing a knowledge about the field. You also grow in your understanding. And by doing that, you become an expert as well. Now, by combining all of these things I've just mentioned, we also show at the bottom job shadowing. By going to and do some job shadowing while at school already, it makes it much easier to make some decisions regarding career fields as well. That's why we encourage our students, and also obviously especially grade 9s, 10, 11s, while they have the time to go out and do some job shadowing as well. Because by then you can see what is a nice thing and what is not so nice things about the workplace environment you think you would like to go in then. If it comes to the admission criteria, if it comes to getting into the university, you find that universities usually work with two sets of admission criteria. The very first thing is where they want to look at, do you actually qualify for degree studies? All right, that's one of the first things they look for. Do you qualify for degree studies? And then the second thing is, you find that they talk about university or faculty specific requirements, where they actually require that you need to show us that you've got some specific subjects together with specific marks for those specific subjects, and then they also talk about the APS score. So let's unpack that quickly. Now, the first requirement I've mentioned there is they want to see that you have got admission for degree studies at least. Now, in order to understand that, we need to look at the outline of the National Senior Certificate that you do. Now, you find in order to qualify with the National Senior Certificate, you need to show us you've got at least 7 subjects. And that will be broken down into two different categories. The first will be 4 compulsory subjects, of which will be your 2 languages, mathematics or mathematic literacy, and then life orientation. So that's your 4 compulsory subjects. Then you have the choice to also select 3 other subjects. And this will be from quite a wide list of different subjects you can take, and obviously what the school then provide. Now, in order to qualify for degree studies in the day, you find they work also with a designated list of subjects. Now, there are rumors currently that this designated list maybe will fall away. From our side, it's not confirmed from our side as yet. So currently, as we follow status quo, we still require that students need to show us they've got at least 50% for 4 designated subjects that forms part of the designated list. Now, you can see there's a whole variety of different subjects on the slide there. And you need to make sure you've got at least 4 of those subjects on that slide on level 4, 50% or more. And as you can see, they talk about the languages, it will be your 2 languages, and then also mathematics and mathematic literacy as well. Both of those are also on the designated list. So all of the students that do subject choices in grade 9 should already have 3 subjects on the designated list already, which means you need to make sure you've got at least another subject on this list and obtain then at least a level 4, 50% or more for those 4 designated subjects in order to qualify for bachelor's degree studies then. And that's the first thing that the universities then look for. Obviously, if the designated list then falls away later on, if it's going to happen, we will see. But what is going to happen then, obviously, this will not be a big issue then. Going into the second set of admission requirements, I was going to skip this one. You find I would like to show you an example of a straightforward table that we use for admissions criteria. You'll find what we're looking at is, first of all, do you have got the right subjects for the specific degree? Now, the example we have on the slide in front of us is for the biochemistry. The biochemistry falls in the group of biological sciences. And for biochemistry, the degree biochemistry, what you find that the faculty is going to require that students need to have at least English, core math, mathematics itself, and then physical sciences. So that's what, like I said, the first thing they're going to look at. Do you've got the right subjects as well? So if you've got mathematic literacy, or if you didn't take physical science as a subject, then obviously you cannot apply for the biochemistry degree. They're going to require that you need to have those 3 subjects. So So in order to understand, once again, it comes back to the first step. Start looking at what is your interest, what is the field you've got an interest in, then therefore make your decisions regarding the subjects as well. Now, in the blocks below the different subjects, you find there's little numbers. Now, depending on what type of examination body you're a part of, the first block is the National Senior Certificate, as well as the IEB block, and then the second block is the A levels, which represents the Cambridge system. Now, you need to achieve that marks for that specific subject in order to also be considered. So in this case, if you look at the table there, the first subject would be language. It indicates a number 5. That means it equates to a 60 to 69%. I can actually just go back to this previous slide there. There you can get a table of how they actually break down the achievement levels. So you can see there a level 5 equates to in the bracket between 60 to 69%. So all the achievement levels, they look at the percentage, and according to the percentage bracket, you actually get your achievement level then. Before I go to the slide again, the third thing they're going to look then is, apart from the fact that you need to have the right subjects, they're also, and the right marks for those specific subjects, they also look at the APS score, or admission point score, like they also call it. Now, how to calculate it is quite straightforward. What we do is, we look at the achievement level of each and every subject you have, excluding life orientation. All right. The reason for that is quite simple, that because life orientation on its own is a 10-credit subject, where all the other subjects are 20-credit subjects. So we unfortunately cannot take the achievement level of life orientation, also put it into the formula of calculating the national the APS score. It will just skew the total at the end of the day. So therefore, what we do is we work with your best 6 subjects, the best 6 subjects, including the subjects that are required for the specific course. If you're going to look at the example again, they're going to look at your best 6 subjects, including, for example, physical sciences as a requirement for the course. So if you have had, for example, I'm just going to give an example, the subject computer application technology as an extra subject, or say 8th subject, for example, and you would like to go and do the BSc Biological Sciences, you can't replace the CAT achievement level or the CAT mark with physical sciences. You need to take into account physical sciences when calculating your APS score then. But if it is that you would like to do a course where physical science is not required, yes, then you can actually substitute CAT with a physical science mark and calculate your APS score. So you work with your best 6 subjects, including the required subjects for the specific course you would like to enroll in. Now, if I'd like to if it comes to calculating the APS score, what you need to do is you need to look at the achievement level for each and every subject. So say, for example, for English, you've obtained 83%, all right? It means you've got already there 7 points. You've got an achievement level of 7, which means you've got 7 points already for your APS score. And then for your mathematics, you also perhaps will have between 70 to 79, so you've got, say, 76%. It means you've got at least achievement level of 6, so you've got another 6 points. Then you add it together, and it will give you then 13 points. So therefore, you add all your achievement levels together, excluding life orientation. And then also, I need to also point out, I know some of the schools also offer the subject Alpha Maths, or add maths, that unfortunately also do not calculate to the APS score. However, I must also just make the note and point out that by taking add maths or alpha maths, it will help you immensely in a great way by coming to university. So the bridge between university, if you want to follow a course where mathematics is a subject, for example, in your course, that step between university and if you're coming from school will be bridged by add maths a lot. So hang on to that AdMaths if you can, but if it gets to a point that you realize that AdMaths or AlphaMaths takes up from your time away in order to actually spend more on subjects that counts towards your APS score, then maybe consider not to leave the AdMaths. But if you can, hang on to that, go through it with it, because it will benefit you a lot later on. Now the question between mathematics and mathematic literacy. Obviously that's a huge, huge question and of big concern for a lot of students as well. What you find is
there's a rumor going along that says that if you're taking mathematic literacy, that you are not going to be able to study. That is not true. You can still go and study a wide variety of different courses by taking mathematic literacy. However, by taking mathematics, it does open up more opportunities and more doors for you. You'll find that in order to actually go and do a course where in the fields of sciences or even the business studies we offer, that you'll find they will require mathematics. All right. So if you realize by after you've been doing your research in terms of the field you would like to go in, and you realize that mathematics is one of the subjects required for that course, then you need to hang on to the mathematics. You need to carry on with mathematics, get extra help with mathematics. And Mr. Peter Lombard will also later on talk about how we at Junior Tiki can also support you with a subject like mathematics. However, if it is that you would like to go into a field where mathematics is not required, for example, the field of law, then you understand that and you realize that you're not that strong in mathematics, there's nothing wrong to move over to mathematic literacy. All right. As a matter of fact, it's going to benefit you in the sense that you're able to do better in mathematical literacy than with mathematics, which will mean that you're going to improve your APS score. Remember, if I can quickly go back to the previous slide there, what we're looking at is, you've got the right subjects for the specific course. In this case, if you're not going to take mathematics for law, then obviously it's perfectly fine. But we also look at is, you've got the right marks, and then last but not the least, the APS score. So by taking mathematical literacy for a course, by taking mathematic literacy and you would like to apply for a course mathematics not required and you know you're not strong in mathematics, it benefits you in the sense that you actually improve your APS score at the end of the day. All right, so choose wisely if it comes to the difference between mathematics and mathematic literacy. From our side, we always encourage take mathematics because obviously it opens up more doors for you. But if you're a candidate that realizes you're struggling with the mathematics, and you're not that interested in going into a field where mathematics is a specific subject, there's nothing wrong to actually select mathematic literacy then. In the booklets, you also find they refer to all the different criteria and admission requirements for all the different courses we offer. And in the booklets, you'll find they have got different columns right next to all the different faculties. Now, as you'll find then, in the column that's the second on the right hand side, you find they indicate to you what is the compulsory subject you need to take for the specific field that you've got an interest in. Now this is an example for the economic and management sciences faculty. They list all the different degrees there. They also indicate to you what is the admission requirements for the specific course. As you can see, they look at the language must be at the level five, so it indicates the level five is a 60% or more for your language, English, and then they also indicate mathematics on the top. So which means that if you want to go into the field of the economic and management sciences, especially for all the BCom degrees, then you need to select mathematics obviously then as well. However, then at the very they also indicate the APS score there, and then like I said on the second column from the right, you find the required subject. So if it comes to the making decisions, make sure then that you follow the second column from the right for the specific school then, or the faculty that you're looking at. On the far right-hand side, you find that there are subjects that list there for you that you can consider. That's like supporting for the field that you've got an interest in. And what you find then, obviously you're looking at subjects that's related then to the business environment then. Business studies, accounting, economics, they're all listed there. What I would like to point out then, there will be a subject they're also looking at, like computer application technology. That is quite a hands-on a type of subject you do, and will give you quite a lot of understanding and how to work with spreadsheets and deal with programs on the computer and all that. That will benefit you also when you come to university, dealing with working with software at the university level. So although currently a subject like computer application technology, from our side, as we can see now, is not on the designated list as yet. By choosing it, you also benefit yourself by having the right tools in your pocket, if I can call it that way, coming to university, working with program software and spreadsheets and stuff like that. There's an example again of they talk about engineering, the built environment, and the information technology. As you can see, once again, they indicated the subjects on the top that you need to have, indicating that your languages, mathematics once again, and as well as your physical sciences, together with all the different degrees in the faculty itself, with the admission requirements for that specific subject or that specific degrees, looking at your English on level 5, mathematics and physical science level 6, it means it equates to a level that equates to 70% or more at least, and then you also have your APS score on 35, together with the columns indicating the subjects. Once again, you'll find that in that the second column from the right, they indicate to you that you need to take mathematics and physical science as subjects for that faculty specifically then. On the far right hand side, once again, there's subjects you can look at that will be supporting to the field of the engineering, the built environment, and the information technology. And as you'll find in the booklet that's been handed out, they give all the different faculties, they give you examples like this, and you can actually follow that by looking at this on the second column from the right, making sure you select the right and correct subject for that specific fields then. Let's have a quick look at the next video. Okay, it seems to me there might not be the video is not going to play at this stage. What I can do at this stage, I can also call Mr. Lombard, Pieters Lombard, to the stage as well. He's going to go into more detailed information regarding the Junior Tiki Club itself, which you can obviously also join if you haven't joined it as yet, which we can support you and help you to improve your marks at school level, but also help you to bridge the gap between school and university. Thank you, Mr. Pieters.
Dames en heren, ladies and gentlemen, it's always strange when you stand in a light and it's totally dark in front of you, but maybe it's fine. I'm Pieters Lombard, I'm the Junior Tiki Project Manager. The Junior Tiki Project started about 12 years ago with two learners. There was a selection in South Africa, Namibia, the old Southwest Africa, where they actually invited three learners to become a part of the launch of the Challenger. You know, I don't think the kids will know if I talk about the Challenger, what it is. It's that thing that took people to the moon, like the astronauts. And then they actually called themselves Junior Ticks. It was two from South Africa and the one from Namibia. And then there was two people, Wallace Isaacs, our deputy director that you will see later, and Dr. Lazenby, that actually started with a dream to create a club. Now, I've got the nicest job in South Africa. I'm running a club at the university, and I've got a lot of kids that's part of my club. The Junior Tiki, okay, you can become a Junior Tiki from grade 9. And that is why we actually started 3 years ago. The Junior Tiki Club was only for grade 10 to 12. And then we realized that we must actually include the grade 9s into this club to become a member and then also receive all the benefits. It's very, very important that you, if you're not part of the club, then we can't communicate with you. And some people ask me, yeah, but what is it in for me if I'm part of the club? The only thing is that you have an office that can help you to get the right information. We assist you, and I will show you on that. Unfortunately, when I was a matric, I will not say what Weimarks was. It was much, much lower. I could not be part of Junior Techies. You must have 70% and more. But we also, people that have 60%, you can also become part of the club, but you will not be a full member. So I always say, I can tell you how to get from less than 50% to 70% plus in two terms. So, and that is what we actually do in the Junior Tiki Club, to help you to get to that 90% that you need to maybe to get into medicine. So you become a member of the club. It costs nothing, not a cent. Now, nothing is for free in South Africa. But it costs nothing. You must just register, and every year you must just register again, update your details. Unfortunately, we have a lot of junior techies. The mum is part of the club, or the dad is part of the club, but the kids don't know when we send them invitations. So hopefully today, I saw on the data list when you register, a lot of you are junior techies, but a lot of you must become junior techies today, and I will quickly show you how to become a member. So what you do then is every year you re-register, and if you change your cell phone or your email, that's the two things that kids regularly change. Please, then you send it to us that we can update it to you, because we will send all the information to the old number. Then when you end up at the university, you will be still part of this club. Then you're part of the JTM Ambassadors Society. And this is all this junior techies that assist you outside and will support you. We also have tutors and those things. So you become part of the club. And then there's always a payback time. You see, everything is for free until you become an alumni. But alumni for us, it's nice if somebody donates 50 rand or 100 rand a month that we can help other junior techies. But we actually want every junior techie. If you sit here today, we want you to go back to your school, and you are looking in your grade 9 class. Is there one kid that I think together we can become junior techies? And you register that kid for us. And as you come and you graduate, it doesn't matter. We would love to get you at the University of Pretoria. That's the main prize. But if you go to another university, please come back for your master's and your honors and your PhD. We also have a small WhatsApp group in Cape Town, because they couldn't get into medicine with us, but they're still there, and they actually every year ask me, can they come back? So very, very important. If you one day, if you reap all the benefits of junior techie, go back into the place where you work, look for a junior techie and support them, and so we try to duplicate. So the alumni, I'm not going to talk about that, but that's for graduates. Then we do a lot of things. I'm just going to, we provide first-hand information on study and career options. It's very, very important. So if you're not 100% sure what you want to do is, we've got a phone number, what you can actually call the junior techie number or send an email, and we will send you to one of the student advisors that can actually assist you. Mostly the kids start from grade 10, to see in which career they can go. What we also do is we develop leadership qualities, and later in this year we will have an online leadership course for the junior techies. So it's going to be very nice. And I just want to say at this time, we live streaming this whole event, so people out in South Africa can specifically see what we are doing. Then also, it's very important for us that you become a part of the community. There's a lot of community projects that we are doing and that you can become involved in. One of the schools in Mpumalanga, actually, we had about 12 junior techies in grade 11 at our empowerment week, and they actually started a food garden at the school. And at this stage, they actually provide about 600 kids with food, one meal a day. So it's actually all the grade 11s is building on this project, and that's what we want to do. Then also, you will have access to all our activities. We've got the Junior Techie Academy. I will talk about that. Normally, if you're now a junior techie and you re-register next year, you will be invited to the October hashtag the grade 10 function, it's actually walk the talk with Junior Turkey, and it's like arts in the park. So we will have our first one this year, because we also include the grade 10s. And then you will be invited to the grade 11 top 10 function. We normally, most of you are top 10 in your school, but there's top 10 learners and junior techies. So if you're not a top 10 in your school and you receive the invitation, it means that you are a junior techie. So you will be invited to all our functions. Then also, we have winter schools. Okay, the grade 12 preparation conference, we only select 200 learners, but we look at those people that actually start from grade 9 to grade 12. You decide that you will end up at the University of Pretoria, you choose UP, and then we'll invite you. Those programs are up from 4 days to a whole week. You must just get to the University of Pretoria and we pay for the rest. We go on the Gautrain, we've got time management, we've got study methods, because all those skills that kids need to make a successful transition from high school to higher education. Then also, like we offer the grade 10 subject choices, then we offer special bursaries. It's nice to give money away to my junior techies. But we will talk with you about that as we go along. Then also, we don't anymore have an open day for UP. We will have a UP virtual campus tour that will actually in a few weeks from now, we will launch that. But the junior techies will be the first to see what the campus is about. But we will also take you on a campus tour, but we will talk about that later. And then also open days. We're going to change that name to open days, because open day means that anyone is welcome. And then unfortunately, there's too many people. So we will have a medicine information session as well as a veterinary science information session. And we're also planning for the BCom faculty, and that's specifically only for junior techies. But if there's other people that don't know about junior techie, we will also include them. But it's on a first come, first basis. We can only take about 600 every year, then it's full. But that will be all for grade 11 or for grade 12, but it's normally for grade 12, but with the vet, we include the grade 10s, 11s, and 12s. So, but we will communicate with you on that. Then we actually also want to build a long-term relationship with you, because it's so nice if you go to a graduation and you saw junior techies that start 9 years ago here, and they actually graduate in their master's or PhD, but they're still part of our community. Then, very, very important. This is basically the thing. I have a background in teaching for 25 years, and the subjects that I struggled at school was maths and science. And then I realized after 11 and a half question papers on the July holiday in grade 12 that maths is very, very easy. And I can tell you, it's not difficult. It's not difficult. As long as you sit on your butt and you study and you work through question papers and believe that you can do it. But that's a story for another day. Then, very, very important, we have our winter school for grade 12. So if you have a kid in grade 12 or 11, remember, it's on our website for maths and science, but we will also live stream it. It's 10 hours of maths and physical science, then summer school for grade 11. And then very, very important, reading in South Africa, they did it. I don't know if you know about I think it's the PULSE reading test that they did. There was a document that came out from our university. They realized there was 50 countries in the world that participate in grade 4. And they found that South Africa is number 50. We last. I'm doing research in reading because that is one of the factors that influence successful transition. It's actually the factor that's the most important for success at university is reading. The next one is listening skills, then creative writing, and then your grade 12 marks. I've got a research that proves that. So the very, very important, kids, learners, you must read as much as possible. When you do a PhD, you have to read about 2,000 books. It took me up to 9 months to do it. And then you start writing your first chapter. But you must read as much as possible. The grade 11s in South Africa, I test them every year, a lot of them. They read on a grade 2 to 3 level and with a 60% comprehension. And I find that results every year. Not higher, rather lower. Doesn't matter. I also did a test on some engineering students and they read on a grade 7 level. So it's very, very important. And we've got a very nice program, Lector Essay Reading, that we actually implemented over the last 9 years. It's online, 20 lessons, 2 per week. It also help you with your vocabulary and everything. And I can tell you, the junior techies, is after that 10 weeks, 6 months, it depends on how you do it. Their comprehension went up, or actually they read on a grade 2 to 3 level. It's up to grade 12, first year level, with up to 80% comprehension. And I received last year's report this week, and if you're interested, I can send it to you. So very, very important, read. If you want to study and make a study and get a lot of degrees, you must read. Then also, we have got English for grade 8 and 9 online, mathematics for grade 8 and 9, and there's also Proverto study guides on our website, or you can just Google Proverto. There's a grade 9 booklet on all the maths for grade 9. Then also calculus. When I arrived here at the university, I realized that 53% of all the junior techies failed calculus maths in engineering. So Dr. Peter Klaassen, my colleague, we actually start bringing in a teacher every Saturday from SABI, and then we realize let's develop this in online. It costs plus minus 600,000 to develop the year program for every subject. When we test this program, we actually give it to 100 engineering students. The pass rate was 89%, 23 distinctions, and 11% fail. So that 11 students that fail didn't even open the program and they get it for free. And that is the big thing. If you get something for nothing, you don't actually deserve that because you don't open it. So that's very important to remember. If you're junior techie, we will have that program. It's three-dimensional. You have a 24-hour teacher online. So please look at our academy. The details are available. Then also, study methods is also very important. And then preparation classes for the national benchmark test. We are very successful with the national benchmark test, but that's later. That's for grade 11 and 12. Okay, then. Very, very important. If you go out today and you don't download the app, you will never, never become a junior techie. I test this. If you tell 100 people to download the app, about 22 of you will now be listening. Then 12 will try to go on the website, and only 2 will register. That's the statistics that I have. But if you have it, all the information is on there. We actually communicate with you. We send notifications. Some of you that already have the app, you received the notification yesterday that we're going to live stream this. If you don't receive it, you must just contact or email me and we will see what's wrong on your side. So that's very, very important. It's very, very easy. You everybody of you know Play Store or Google, and you just go in there and put in Junior Tekkie and immediately it will open. Last year, we won 2 excellence prizes for this. Best app for all universities in South Africa, and we also for the SA Publication Board, with companies like, I don't want to mention the banks or Mango or all those people, we also won the top prize for the best app. So, and you're going to see, you're going to love it. All your question papers is there. There's a lot of information. So please download the app. Mums and dads, you can also download the app. And you will also get all the information. You can even apply online on that. And there's also nice, in that app is also a camera that you can take a selfie and maybe send it to us and so on. Okay, so there's all the details, but I think it will also be in your pack and everything. Then our website, there's all the information. I'm not going to talk. What is Junior Tekkie about? Apply for membership, JT Academy, math study tips, sponsors and partners, projects, photos, videos. There's a lot of things. We receive between 20 to 80,000 leads per month. So it's very, very important. Every detail is there. So you don't have to go. But like I said, Google is my best friend. My wife is my best friend, but Google also, you just put in something and it gives you the answer. So, and that's very, very nice. Okay, our website. And I know I did tell you a lot of things, but if you can only remember this. Okay, on the bottom. Junior.Tekkie. Remember the dot. If I don't answer you in, say, 24 hours, I normally try over the weekend. It's a little bit slower, but if I don't answer you in a day or so, it means I didn't receive it. But remember, junior.tekkie@up.ac.za. But I actually realized over the last 2 weeks that Gmail, actually, if you don't put in that dot, it takes a few days and they will send the email to you. But please, also this. Okay, our contact numbers is on the website. You can also get it there, but it's better to email us. Okay, I'm going to ask quickly to Junior Tekkie, Julia Mamambola. She's a final year student, BSc, humans, physiology, genetics, and psychology, as well as Dia Renee Prakosh, first year student, BSc, biological science, to the States just to tell their success stories and what the role of Junior Tekkie is in their life. And hopefully, if you're first year or second year, we will invite you here. Thank you. Over here.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. As they have mentioned, my name is Julia Mamabolo, a final year student in BSc, Human Physiology, Genetics, and Psychology. In all these 3 majors I have mentioned, psychology just happens to be my favorite. Beyond what I am studying, I am most passionate about giving back, participating in community engagement projects, and providing guidance to others. It is always a great pleasure to see your hard work impacting someone else's lives and making them smile. And that is what has encouraged me to join Junior Tekkie, because the Junior Tekkie motto is inspiring future leaders. I have joined Junior Tekkie in 2014, and last year I had the opportunity to head the project subcommittee, which is one of our many subcommittees under the Junior Tech Student Ambassador Society. And that has given me an opportunity to plan projects such as this, in that I got a lot of experience. Our guidance was just saying that people think that students after university have no experience, but for us Junior Techies, we already have this experience and we can actually add it to our CV. What I love most about Junior Techie is the opportunities it gives us as students and learners as yourself. For me, it gives me a chance to do what I love most, which is to lead. And for you guys, it gives you firsthand information, as he showed you on the on our website, that you guys can get anything. And if you want more information, you can just email him. Who else can get that chance? Ask any leader where they have started, and they will tell you that behind them, there was a mentor, a teacher, a parent, or someone guiding them. And for me, that is what I inspire to do. I inspire to aspire others before I actually expire. Well, because you guys are still in grade 9, you might think that information, this information we're giving you is irrelevant to you guys. But I've also been there. I've been in grade 9, grade 10, grade 11 and stuff, and here I am as a final year student. So I would like to encourage you guys to take this information that you're getting and to treasure it and utilize this opportunity. If you're unsure of something, ask, because you never know what that little information may lead you to. You might need it in the future. Otherwise, I feel like Junior Techie has given me the opportunity to be the best version of myself thus far. And I am still improving on that. And I am still passing the knowledge I am gaining and also learning something new every day. Thank you.
Hi everyone, how are we doing today? Okay, that's good. So I'm just going to quickly tell you a little bit about my journey as a Junior Techie. I mean, Julia and everyone's really put a really lovely program together, including Mr. Lombard, and they probably explained Junior Techie really well. So I've been a Junior Techie member since grade 9, so obviously the year that you guys are in. And I think it's a really nice place to start off, since it definitely has one of those important turning points in your high school career, and that's choosing subjects. And for me, choosing subjects is quite a daunting task, and it also happens to be when Junior Techie came into play for me. So coincidentally, I was at a talk at my brother's school back at home, and that's when I found out about Junior Techie. And I was really interested in it, so I did a bit of research, and then I signed up that night. And from then, I haven't regretted it, I haven't looked back. For me personally, I believe that school alone did not fully prepare me for university. And in those gaps that I had, Junior Techie really helped and filled in for me. Junior Techie really taught me as a student to defy the odds, push through the boundaries that surround myself and any other student. And for each of us, it's different, no matter how big or small that is. And you know, going through high school, there were many times where not just me, but I'm sure every other student is tempted between doing what's right, and I wouldn't say what's wrong, but particularly not so right. And what I mean by that is by doing something that would put me one step closer to achieving, one step closer to doing well, one step closer to going to university, or just sitting and doing absolutely nothing. And let me tell you, that happens more times than we'd all like. And so being part of the Junior Techie program, it really gave me the confidence to pursue what it is that I want to pursue. And definitely by me standing here today and talking to you guys as a first year mathematical science student, that was just the one thing. And it really shows that by starting off right, maximizing the support systems that the Junior Techie program provides for you, it really helps you to fulfill what it is that you want to fulfill. So I'm just going to leave you guys with this. Never let anyone make you believe that it's impossible, because you give power to what you believe in. Thank you.
It's always strange when the parents are with the learners. The learners don't laugh. But if they laugh, I always said, remember, when I was your age, we had that brick phones, we used maps and everything. But still our calculator is here in your head. We didn't have calculators. So, okay, that's part of Junior Tiki. Hope you become part of the family. The student advisors will be available at the back if there's any questions that you have. I will also be there, and maybe if there's a question, you can talk to us. And yeah, thank you very much, and join the Junior Tiki Club.
Thank you, Johan. Thank you, Petrus. I have this announcement that I want to make prior to my calling one of my colleagues to come and give vote of thanks, that for those of you who parked in the engineering building, please make sure that when you get out into the foyer and then you see Eunice and then you exchange your parking tickets for the free one, so that you're not going to pay for the parking. And then on that note, ladies and gentlemen, I also want to indicate that for those of you who did not go to the different faculties, we still have got some faculties downstairs, and then you can immediately after this go and see them, ask questions in terms of whatever queries and questions that you still have. And I would love to, at this point in time, request Mr. Wallace Isaac on stage so that he can come and render the vote of thanks and also launch VUGA. Mr. Wallace, over to you. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Tebogo. Really appreciate that introduction there. And I would just like to say that it's truly been, I think, amazing just to see what the University of Pretoria actually has to offer. And especially if you participate and become a member of the Junior Turkey Initiative, I think it's a wonderful opportunity that you have to excel, to utilize all the skills and the talents you have, and hopefully become part of this university and help us to excel when it comes to all the achievements that have already been indicated. I would just like to say, first and all, there's two things I need to do, and one is to say the word of thanks. So on behalf of the Junior Turkey, I want to thank Prof. Karolina Kuranov for her motivational speech. She gave quite a bit of information about what we have to offer, and I hope you've taken notes, and who knows, maybe we can do a Junior Turkey quiz and you can answer some of those questions. Then to our program director, Mr. Maponya, thank you for handling this ceremony so excellently. Please give him a round of applause. To the team that was involved in organizing this event, Ms. Selena Davids and her team, thank you very much. The faculties that are downstairs with the exhibitions, and we really appreciate your support to the Junior Turkey office. The University of Pretoria, obviously, this is a very lovely venue. The parking arrangements, as well as for the Junior Turkeys for the refreshments. The Junior Turkey Ambassador Society for their assistance. They are the ones walking around. I think they've got their red t-shirts on. Thank you. You are really helping to make everything go smoothly and everything nicely organized. Mr. Stephen Ball, for his presentation about the sports activities and the achievements. I must be honest, I'm not a sports person. I get tired when I watch TV of people running and the Commonwealth and all of that. It's just, yo, go for it. Woo-hoo! Support you. Yeah, thank you. But for me, it's not. But I hope you guys are excited to do this thing. You need supporters. I'm a supporter, you know, on that side, not the running people. But, I mean, it's amazing. You're healthy, you're wonderful, and you can achieve on the world stage if you want to become one of our athletes through Turk Sport. Then to Johan Kloppers, that have done the presentation on the university and the subject requirements. I hope that's been very helpful and insightful. I hope that's one of the main reasons why you are here today. Mr. Pietrus Lombard, his presentation on the Junior Turkey initiatives and what we have to offer. I must say I really enjoyed that last video. That was quite a nice video. Thank you, Pietrus, for that. Very helpful. Then, what do you think about the astronauts? One of our residences, thank you very much, Astorov, for taking time out of your busy schedule. I know they're busy with exams and study times as well, to come and show their performance that they did at Step Up. Then to the people from that spoke as well, Putti, Moses. No. Those are the staff from the OLA that are busy helping us. Every time that we have an event such as this, they need to get this venue ready for us. So Putti, Moses, thank you very much for making this venue speak and span for all of us. Then, finally, we just see if we covered everyone. Yes, seems like it. Finally, I come to our very special guests, the parents and the grade 9 learners. You've been very patient. You've been very quiet as well. But now I was at a conference and they asked people to stand up and rub each other's shoulders. I'm not going to ask you to do that. And that kept everybody very excited afterwards. But what I am going to ask you is to smile at the person next to you, give them a high five, and just say thank you for being here. You know? Please just do that. Yes, Yara? All of you guys, just do that. High five, thank you for being here. You know, give them a hug. Hey, you've been quiet, you've been great. No, we just, you know, this is good. Okay? Also, those ones at the back that came late, it's fine. You can also do that. It's fine. You can give just, you know. Yeah. Time's very important. Okay. So thank you very much for taking time out of your schedules, and hopefully you've learned something, grade 9 learners. I'd just like to say from my side, there's something else I've got to do, and I've got to launch a particular program. But we do have faith in you. It might be early, but we hope the University of Pretoria will be here in a couple of years, and that you will matriculate as well, and hopefully come to the University of Pretoria. So there's a future for you in South Africa. Adam. Then, this is something which I'm very excited about, and that's a competition. Should we do it now? Okay. No. Let me first do the competition. Under your seat, there should be something. There should be a sticker under your seat. Do the sticker thing first, and then I'll tell you what it's all about. If you found the sticker, just wave and please come to the front. If you found the sticker, please wave, come to the front. Just come to the stage. No, no, that way, lady, there. Yes, you can be faster. That's fine. Don't be afraid. Don't be shy. Come. There should be three. So if you can come to the stage, you're welcome to do so. I just come closer. I just want to see. Fantastic. We've got, yes, it would seem we've got three candidates. And I also asked Mr. Pietrus Lombard to join us on stage. Maybe you guys can stand over here. Sorry, sir. Maybe you could stand over here, then you can just watch the screen, because I'm just quickly. Maybe you can stand here, and you can just watch the screen, okay? And then I'll just quickly go through that. Now, you guys are the first to hear about the University of Pretoria VUCA UP Loyalty Program. This program will cover the following benefits. For just a joining fee of 480 Rand, you will be able to access these benefits. Half price dining at Spur, 2-for-1 benefit for airtime, and you can see that, I'm not going to go through the details as such, you can see it on there. I like Kentucky, so I'll probably be using that voucher quite soon. Half price KFC voucher. And the most important one, I think, for the youth. Next slide, please. Movie voucher. 2-for-1 new metro as well, and then added some popcorn onto that. Why have we decided to start this initiative? We've got so much positive feedback from people being part of the Junior Turkey Initiative that we thought maybe it's time that we see if we can give something back as well. And just to appreciate your loyalty and your support at the end of the day. So, but you are the first to hear about this. So what we've done is we've got three individuals. Please come and just share your names.
Katrin Bosso. Daniela Osai.
Danny Naika.
And you are the first three people that will be getting VUCA vouchers, sponsored by the University of Pretoria, the Junior Turkey Office, worth 480 Rand. Thank you very much. Pietrus, you will do the information. What I will say to the rest of you guys, it was announced to me that in the week, if I'm not mistaken, we will be able to send you the information and the details of how you can become one of our UP VUCA members. And I hope all of you will be able to join. I'm very excited. I think we're one of the first universities to do this if we get everything right. Let me just see, is there anything else that I should mention? No, ladies and gentlemen, from my side, that's it. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Wallace. It is always so nice to sit down and listen to Wallace speak, because he's got such brilliance of speech that he can be able to present whatever. I believe he can be able to sell coal to the people that are in Witbank, most definitely. So on that note, I'm just going to make my final closing remarks. And these are the remarks that I'm going to make. And then I want you to listen very attentively. From here, we are going to get some refreshments. And then now the organizers and the people that are arranging all these things have requested me to say this to you, that we should start with the vegetarians. And then now they'll be the ones, the first ones to get. I'm not so sure why vegetarians, whether it's because, you know, the Garden of Eden was the first one to be there or what, I'm not so sure. But now most definitely the vegetarians will be the ones to go out, and then you'll get your refreshments, and the rest of us, you know, carnivores and omnivores will later come at a later stage. And then now this is the other announcement that I want to make, that please, like I indicated, I said there are evaluation forms which are in your packs, but I said that you're going to complete on the online. Listen to me very attentively. Complete those online evaluation questionnaires at www.up.ac.za/juniataki, and then now you go to evaluation questionnaires and then you click on the link. And then now if you provide your cell phone number at the end of that online questionnaire, your number will be entered into a lucky draw on Monday, the 28th of May, a day just before my birthday. And I hope I'm going to get present from each one of you. And then now, three cell numbers will be drawn, and each will receive a VUCA app loyalty program and then compliments of Junior Techie. Allow me to repeat, the process, www.up.ac.za/JuniorTechie, and then you go to evaluation questionnaire, and then you also click on the link. On that note, this marks the end of our day with you, and thanks so much for being such a lovely audience. And then I want to say to you, I love you all. Nginithanda nonke emakhaya. Drive safely back home, and God bless. Thank you very much.